Good afternoon, and welcome to Legacy Hall. At this time, we ask that you please silence all cell phones and other noise-making devices. If you must leave, please do so during the applause between pieces. Lastly, any unauthorized audio or video recording is strictly prohibited. Thank you, and enjoy the performance.
Set with the piece titled Lost Maples, and then we'll switch to Synergy after that, just the reverse of the program.
Thank you. Patrick. I'm from Canada. Eh? I wasn't going to talk before beginning the show. I was actually going to start with the music, but I have a few things to say. First of all, let's congratulate that high school outreach group, I believe. I'm not familiar with their name. Another round of applause. I heard them from backstage, as I often do. Myself, I also direct an international festival in Montreal, also known as Guitar Montréal. And I believe at this point in my career, with my own concerts and this other thing that I do, I've now listened to more concerts back there than out there. Those of you who direct music ensembles and festivals will understand what I'm saying. The theme of my program, there actually is one, is anniversary. I will share some anecdotes with you along the way in regards to the pieces I'm playing. This first piece, Hyperion, even though in the published score it states that it was published in 2010, was actually premiered and the first copy of it came out in 2009, so you can do the math. At this point, also in 2009, there's a lot of other interesting things happening and that had happened 10 years prior, but we'll get to that when we get to that. Hyperion is a subject matter of the before the Olympians, so the Titans. John Keats wrote an epic poem, and I do not use the word lightly, to describe this period in mythology where the Titans are usurped by the Olympians. And this composer, Harry Staphylakis, young Canadian composer, who's currently the composer in residence for the Winnipeg Symphony Orchestra, decided to use the guitar, quietest of all instruments, to describe this epicness. It's in three parts, sort of slow, fast, chaotic, and slow again. Hope you enjoy.
Thank you.
of pieces are very, very special to me because it was back in 1999, so again, do the math, that I was invited to Germany to record these with a small independent German label. And on this record were a bunch of Canadian pieces and new pieces. The Suite by Jacques Itzu at that point in time had not been overly recorded, and so I took upon myself the opportunity to study with the composer at his home, and it was an eye-opener, of course, as it always is. He let me in on a few little secrets and a few little things, of which hopefully in the next few months we will see on YouTube. I'm still waiting permission from the estate to published this on YouTube. Jacques Itzu passed in 2010. The suite is in five pieces. You have prelude that pretty much sets the mood, the nocturne, which is a night scene, the ballade, which is a play on words, which the French love to do. I'll explain that in a short bit. Rêverie, which means a dream state or a daydream state. And finale, which is essentially just a big final piece. The word ballade in French can mean what it means in English in music, which means when we write a ballad, has a particular form, has a particular style and aesthetic. This can also be the way we use the word in French. The word ballade also can mean stroll, or gentle walk, or fun walk, depending on how your ballade is going. You can also take a balade, not necessarily walking. You can take a balade on your bike, or a car, or any moving vehicle, for that matter. So I play around with that a little bit. I used to play this piece quite a bit at the end of the 90s, and a little bit into the 2000s, but I let it go, and I'll tell you why I let it go. Because I didn't think I was playing it right, or the audience just didn't like the music, because I wasn't getting much positive feedback from it, so I decided to put it aside. Many years go by, and I go back to the piece, revisit it, knowing that Jacques Itzu's anniversary is coming around the corner, which was last year, incidentally. 1938 is when he was born. And I was invited to play a concert in Montreal in which I did kind of an honor to Jacques Itzu. Upon revisiting the piece, I was able to dig deep and figure something out about myself that has helped me interpret the piece differently. And that is the 80s. I hear some of you laughing here because there's actually a whole sidebar thing going on with the 80s with a friend of mine right now, which is kind of fun, but it has nothing to do with this concert. I'm sure in the States it was just as fear-impacted as it was in Canada on the media. Those of you around in the 80s understand what was going on. And it was always in the media. It was always, Russia has this many bombs. The US needs more. What's Canada going to do? Is Canada going to keep their upkeep on the radar system up north? Which we did. Forget what it was called. Anyway. Radar system against ballistic missiles and stuff. In any case, I grew up as a teenager in that decade. And it hit me like a ton of bricks. This piece was written in 1986. And what artists will do, at least the good ones, is get influenced by what's going on around them. Whatever it may be. And this subconsciously makes it into their art, whether they like it or not. This is the artistic phenomenon. And so when I got that, I understood the angst. I understood the anxiety in a different way now in this music. So all this to describe to you that this music is very anxiety, it's full of anxiety and a little bit of that sort of color. So if you don't like it, that's fine. You don't have to like this musical aesthetic. But I finally got it. There's got to be a connection there. And so I went back and I dug deep and I remembered my walks to high school using an auto-reverse Walkman, listening to my music, but at the same time, as I'm enjoying this pleasure, always in the back of my mind was, can today be the day? Is today the day one of those guys is going to press on the button? And so this stuck with me. And now I've dug deeper into this piece and have tried to find some of those elements to help me out, deal with my issues as a teenager. So anyway, hope you enjoy it, angst and all. System. This next piece doesn't have any anxiety, or not the same sort. Le Bourdon de l'âme by Patrick Roux. Le Bourdon de l'âme does not mean anything specific in French, apart from it being a very nice poetic sentence. roughly translated, would mean the drone of the soul, which doesn't translate all that well. The colors of the language are lost a little bit, and I am not a professional translator. The piece is in two sections, even though the program doesn't state it. We have a slow, brooding first section, which is called songe. And the word songe in French is very similar to the word rêverie we had in the Jacquetsu, which is, but the word songe is more specific. It literally does, most of the time, mean daydream. Or to think in a nostalgic manner about something. Est-ce que tu es en train de songer à la solution du problème, which would mean, are you in thought about the, you know, answer to the problem? But the word songe can be used that way as well. The composer told me years ago, again, back in 1999, because this one yet again made it on my Stringendo album. It was recorded in 1999. So I worked with the composer, and he let me in on the fact that this piece was a way for him to release an earworm. Many composers go through this. Many of us go through this. We hear something on the radio or in a playlist, and it just sticks with us all day long, sometimes more than a day. If a composer, again, I'm generalizing, puts this down, works with it, usually the problem is solved. So this is what the second movement of it is. The second movement is him fooling around with that idea and then eventually putting it down on paper. The first section is him thinking about how to solve this problem. So the piece is really not that deep. It's just a fun time with the creative process. Patrick Roux and I are very good friends. We met back in 1994, 95 at the Domaine Forget, which is a musical camp northeast of Quebec City. Beautiful place. You should visit. Lots of whale watching in that area, if you're into that sort of thing. And when we met, he was instantly attracted to giving me his music. He says, I know that you're still a student right now and you've got a lot of things to work on, but here's a pile of my music. Have fun with it. And at the time, I remember asking him, which one of these is close to your heart? And at that time, he mentioned Le Bourdon de l'Homme, which is why I decided to start working on this one, and it has been in and out of my program since then. The piece was actually written for David Russell, because Patrick Roux had gotten a grant from the Canadian government to go study with Russell in private at David's home. At that time, David was spending most of his time in London. And so Patrick Roux got an earful of Maestro David Russell. So the piece was written for David, but David did not get around to playing it until, I believe, 2006, 2007, somewhere around there. And I just recently found that out. I had no idea. I've been playing the piece, as I said, off and on since the late 90s. And I'd love to hear David Russell's interpretation of this. If any of you have a bootleg copy, come see me backstage afterwards. The program states that there is no pause. I'd like to take a pause after this piece. Very short, 5 minutes. I have to get some water, I'm parched. And I've got a little tuning to do, if that's okay with you. 5 minute break after this piece.
Thank you. Thank you.
Sonata 3 by Manuel Maria Ponce is part of the canonical classical guitar repertoire. Has been played many, many times all over the world, and was written by the was written for the very famous guitarist Andrés Segovia. It's in three standard movements: fast, slow, fast. And I mentioned there'd be some anniversary stories as I spoke. Well, this one also connects with the record that I released back in 2009. So there you go. There's the math again. And it was in 2009 that I released an entire recording of the works of this brilliant Mexican composer. While he was in Paris in the 20s, he studied at a school called L'École Normale de Musique de Paris, and he studied a composition with Paul Duca, who was of the French Impressionistic school of writing. His lessons were not necessarily always geared to French Impressionism, but while in Rome, why not? So all of his music from this period has a little bit of flavor of this influence, this French Impressionistic influence, and none so much so than this following sonata in three movements.
Thank you. Thank you.
As well. Back in 1999, I was getting ready to go to Germany to record an album, of which you've heard a lot of music tonight. The Suite by Jacques Itu, Les Bourdons de l'âme by Patrick Roux. It's a home studio, as a lot of small studios can be. And the sleeping quarters that my wife and I were sequestered to was right next door to the recording area. There was no choice in the matter. Supposedly, this is how it had to be. She was seven months pregnant at this time with my first wee one, Benjamin. And all you women out here who have had children before, you know what 7 months means when you're lying down or sitting or moving. It's not very comfortable. And we would get, in between sessions, the producer would get onto the talkback mic and say, "Patrick, what was that sound? I heard a weird sound. Was that you moving in the room?" I said, "No, I don't think so. I think it might be my wife next door. You've told her she's got to stay there." He says, "Okay, fine." All this to say is my son, even before being born, got an earful of music, guitar music, which is probably why he doesn't play it today. He's had his fill. Now, my son is more of a pianist than he is a guitarist. So it was in this time that music was born for my son, and I have beautiful memories of this time. So some months go by, I come back home, and a good friend of mine, who some of you might know, Andrew Zone calls me up and says, "Hey Pat, we've booked a house for the GFA to kind of save costs on hotel, do you want in?" I said, "Yes." And we had a great time, you know, networking, doing the business slash pleasure type thing. And I get there late on the evening before the festival begins, the symposium begins. And he says, "Pat, I've just written some beautiful new music. Can I play some for you?" So I say, "Yeah, of course." Although I'm tired, I've been flying. But he grabs his guitar, and as masterful as he always is, all the fingers are in the right place at the right time. And I hear this piece for the first time, and it's absolutely gorgeous, but very different than most other things he had already written, because Andrew had already written some music before this time. And I said, "This is beautiful. You know, what's with the departure?" He says, "Well, I felt like writing a lullaby," or something of that nature. I don't remember the exact rhetoric, but it was something of that nature. And I said, "Wow, that's great. You do know that my son was born 3 weeks prior, and it was difficult for me to come here, you know, with her being having a newborn and everything, but, you know, the reservations were made." So he says, "Wow, that's fantastic. Congratulations. How about I dedicate this lullaby to your son?" And I thought, I want to get to know this guy better. We've been great friends ever since. Whenever I have a chance to be around Andrew, it's always a good time. It's always fun. There's always a lot of friendship. And it's one of those friendships that I just really want to continue going on in my life. You know, some of you have those kinds of friends. It's really great. And so that he also dedicated a piece to my son, that was also very touching. It's too bad it took me all those years to actually put it on my program, but so be it. So it was back in 1999 that Andrew Zone dedicated this to my son, who had already gotten an earful of music.